for the delay. As usual, there were IT issues. And please forgive the name, which reads as seminar, which I cannot change by some means. So I'm Dr. Tanuja Karande, consultant in pediatric cardiology. I specialize in pediatric heart failure and transplant. And today's topic is acute heart failure in a child in ICU. Discuss in brief the clinical parameters and acute management of heart failure in the ICU. And I'm going to touch upon topics of mechanical circulatory support and how do we transition to anti-failure medications once the acute failure is controlled. There has been a lot of advances in heart failure therapy in terms of classification and management when it comes to adults with ischemic heart disease and heart failure. But very limited research has been done in pediatric heart failure. As we know, in pediatric heart failure, the child can be in a heart failure due to a lot of reasons compared to adults, which has quite a limited ischemic causes for heart failure. So in children, we can have structural lesions, which may be obstructive, valvular, regurgitant, ischemic, post-shunts, post-single ventricle failed palliations, etc. 60% of the time we do face with post cardiomyopathies and children who come to you with the first episode of myocarditis. Definitely rhythm failure and the, whatever is said and done is the reason, the goal will be to improve the stroke volume and the cardiac output. I'm not going to touch upon the congenital structural heart lesions because they have specific modes of therapy based on the lesions. What we are going to discuss today is the two scenarios which is very commonly faced by the pediatric cardiologist, that is acute myocarditis, which presents to you with first episode of acute heart failure and acute deterioration, and or a chronic cardiomyopathy which has got unnoticed and is coming to you with acute deterioration. Both of these can further progress into a refractory heart failure, which may require a mechanical support, and that is what we are going to discuss today. So in terms of assessment, it is very important to differentiate between the two pathologies of whether it is an acute myocarditis that you are dealing with or it is an acute heart failure in a child with a chronic cardiomyopathy. And there are certain pointers in terms of history, in terms of echo and your investigations, which will give you clues. So let's start with the assessment of such a child. Definitely duration of illness is very, very important. But apart from duration of illness, you have to ask for subtle features which may be missed by parents or the child. And these symptoms you can group into three. Firstly, low cardiac output symptoms. In an infant, you can ask for irritability. In a slightly older child, you can ask for fatigue and weakness. If you have a child who used to initially go to school on a cycle and doesn't do so anymore, that is a pointer. If you have a child who is to play with his friends for one hour daily, definitely in the pre-COVID era and doesn't play so now, that is also a pointer, which tells you that a child has been having a chronic pathology which has been going on. Second symptom, symptomatology which you have to ask is for poor perfusion. So reduced urine output. Now this is a little bit difficult to ask, but in an older child you can ask initially how many times he would visit the toilet and how many times he goes now. Whether the child sleeps longer for a longer duration. So initially he wouldn't sleep in the afternoons of after school or after doing homework, and now is wanting to go to sleep for a period of say 1 hour, 2 hours, and is asking for some rest. GI symptoms very, very common, and you will find even adolescents having symptoms of early morning vomiting. It is usually because of bowel edema and bowel congestion. Slightly younger children like 4 to 5 years old will give you history of abdominal pain. Though they are hungry, they would want to eat and they will take small bites and then they will stop eating because there is abdominal pain. Even diarrhea is a symptom of heart failure or low cardiac output. Finally, third symptom to ask, which is very, very obvious, is increased work of breathing and wheezing. So in case of chronic cardiomyopathy, you will get such subtle signs and subtle symptoms in history, which will be absent in a case of acute myocarditis, which has a pretty much of an acute history. Once we have our assessment done, we need to sort of classify them, and there are very good objective classifications available in adults, but as compared to that, in children we just have the Ross scoring system, and which is equivalent to the adult NYHA. The Ross has been further modified and it has been made a little bit like a scoring objective system. However, I do not really see many of us use this because of its clinical utility. So the initial Ross classification of heart failure has been further made more objective into mild heart failure, moderate heart failure, and severe heart failure. This is a new classification. It is not that new, so it is relatively new. So once you have a child who's come to you in heart failure, we should classify him into four groups of clinical syndromes, into ABCD type of heart failure. Now, the x-axis is for congestion and the y-axis is their low perfusion. And based on the yes and no, we divide them into A, which is a warm and dry type of heart failure, B, which is warm and wet, that means there is not much of low. That means the cardiac output is maintained, but there is more of congestion. Now, this is quite common. Say you have a 10-year-old who's come to you with acute heart failure. Usually, they will come to you in a stage B of classification of heart failure, which is warm and wet, where the perfusion is sort of maintained by the compensatory mechanisms. There is significant congestion in terms of hepatomegaly. So in terms of congestion, you have to look for high JVP, you have to look for ascites, tests of basal Krebs, abdominal jugular reflux, and edema. In terms of low perfusion, that is your y-axis, look for narrow pulse pressure. Now, this is one of the very important signs. So if you have a pulse pressure reading which is less than 40, it tells you that the child is in compensated heart failure. If your investigations are showing declining serum sodium, again tells you that there is RAS system which is in on the play, and that's why there is dilutional hyponatremia. So for low perfusion, look for cool extremities, look for a narrow pulse pressure. And now based on this, you divide the child into ABCD because your treatment management protocol is going to vary for each type. Out of all the signs which we look for, there are few prognostic signs, or there are certain signs on auscultation which tells you whether the child is still in heart failure or out of heart failure when you started your management. So first is definitely low pulse pressure. Secondly, muffled heart sounds. Now this is a very commonly found sign which we see in acute myocarditis, where the S1 and S2 are not as crisp as they should be. And the S1 is soft at the apex irrespective of presence of MR or TR. Presence and persistence of S3, so LV S3 is what you look for, whether it is intermittent or whether it is there with every cardiac cycle, and the presence of cough, whether wet or dry, both are important. So what we usually find is in cases of acute myocarditis where the pulmonary capillary wedge pressure rises acutely, they usually have dry cough wherein they try to increase their PEEP by coughing against a closed glottis every time. As compared to children where they are sort of in compensated heart failure, they produce wet cough because of congestion. Once you have got the lines in, the ART line, definitely we know that there is no doubt the utility of an ART line in the presence of acute heart failure, but there are certain things which require attention. Firstly, not only the reading of the blood pressure, but also the shape and the area under the curve. In the trace. Secondly, prominence of exaggerated fall of systolic blood pressure during breathing, or during when the child is even standing up or say sitting up from a supine position, it tells you that the left ventricle is very, very sensitive to preload and afterload changes, and it also indicates that your child might be hypovolemic, and that is why it is showing a swaying sort of a trace. In terms of your central line and the central CVP line, you have to keep an eye on the saturations of which the SVC saturation, which we know that they decline in the presence of low cardiac output. Your goal for a SVC saturation should be beyond 65, and 70 plus is better. So these are some arterial traces of the same child. On the left upper quadrant, you can see this was, though the child is not tachycardic with a basal heart rate of around 120, he is still having narrow pulse pressure. The systolic is 81, the diastolic is 58. The second trace that is on the right upper quadrant is showing, this is on the second day, the heart rate seems a little bit well acceptable. This was a 12-year-old child who came to us in acute heart failure. But you can see exaggerated dichrotic notches. Now these occur because of the reflection or the pulse wave reflection from your peripheral arterioles. So which tells you that the child is still compensating or is still having a high SVR, even though the pulse pressure is slightly better. And the arterial trace in the right lower quadrant, you can see the difference between the dichrotic notches, though I think the scale has been tweaked by someone. But the shape of the dichrotic notches is more towards the baseline. It is not as peaked. So it tells us that our management is going on the right path. So this is a very important chart which you can do. There are just 5-6 parameters which require monitoring. If you have a child in acute heart failure, which will tell you whether you are going on the right path or not. So first is weight, and we do not really give as much importance to daily weight monitoring in an ICU or a child who is sick because of all the lines, etc. But weight tells us a lot in terms of the volumic status of the child. We already discussed S3, so what you can chart is either S3 is present or it is intermittent or it has disappeared. So on day 2, day 3, by usually day 3, S3 should disappear. The pulse pressure, so you can write the number, say it was 30 on admission, and what happened to it on day 2, what happened to it on day 4. So this chart will sort of give you an idea whether we are stagnating in our management or we are having some progress. Sodium is a very important parameter, and it also tells you whether the failure is under control or he's still having dilutional hyponatremia and you need to increase your inotropes or not. Not just based on sodium definitely, but all these parameters at the end of it will give you an idea whether you can come down on your milrinone or whether you need to increase the dose of milrinone. And one of the most important investigations is NT-proBNP. Which should ideally reduce by half in the next 3 to 4 days of your management. But even a 30% fall from baseline tells you that you are doing a good job. So in terms of investigations, we know what to see in X-ray, but there are certain points to remember that supine X-rays have limited values. 20% of patients with acute heart failure may have normal X-rays. Pulmonary venous congestions is what you look for, septal lines, pleural effusions, interstitial edema, and cardiomegaly. So if you have cardiomegaly, you know that this has been a chronic process. Now in echo, apart from the LV function and volume assessment, there are certain echo parameters which are important in assessment of a child with heart failure. Firstly is LV strain, and I'm not going to go into the details, but we know the importance of LV strain and myocardial strain imaging, and its advantages. So basically, it is not affected by preload afterload conditions. It is more sensitive to changes rather than your LVEF by Simpson's method or other methods like MMODE. It gives you small changes because it is a speckle tracking of a small area. So the myocardium is divided into sectors, and it is further divided into smaller myocardial echogenic speckles, and it traces the movement of these speckles, and it gives you overall strain. So it will give you a reading something like your global longitudinal strain, which is only in the longitudinal, the movement in the longitudinal axis, which should normally ideally be beyond minus 20 for a child. It also measures not only the longitudinal, but it also measures the circumferential and the radial strain, and thus it gives you a more specific and it is a more sensitive indicator than your EF, which is, does not measure the LV function in all dimensions. So LV strain and LV filling pressures, so, or LA pressures. Now the importance of LA pressures are it will tell you whether you need to decongest the child more or whether the child is improving or deteriorating. So for example, now these are the echo the parameters, which this I have borrowed from the adult guidelines of acute heart failure parameters to be monitored. So this is published in DAC of 2020 in Heart Failure Journal. So out of all these parameters, you are going to get a restrictive or you are going to get a diastolic dysfunction. But out of all these parameters, the most important one is E by E dash, and which will sort of tell you whether the LA pressures are still elevated. So average is more than 14. It tells you whether the LA pressures are still elevated and what it was at baseline, that is at admission, followed by what it is at day 2 or day 3, and whether you are doing adequate management of the child. This is a recent article in European Society, published in European Heart Journal, which talks about old and compares the newer echocardiographic parameters in heart failure. This can definitely be reciprocated in our children or adolescents with myocarditis and heart failure. It basically has translated the speckled strain into a 3D sort of volume. And it gives you the function in a better way than what a speckled tracking would do, but you do require the program in your machine. Now, lung ultrasound, the adults talk a lot about this, and we can apply this again in older children, say beyond 6 to 8 years, though there are no papers in pediatrics. So what this says is that there are certain lines which appear because of interstitial edema, though they are not very specific for heart failure. So you can get these lines even if in a pathology which is causing interstitial edema other than heart failure, like say some sort of infection. But for heart failure, there is something known as a COMET score. Now this divides your thorax, or say the right hemithorax, you divide it into 6 or 9 areas and you count the number of B lines. Now in the second diagram, you can see that these are echogenic lines which run sort of perpendicular to a rib or to the pleural surface, and they are usually separated by more than 6 to 7 millimeters, and you can count them. So based on the number of B lines, you can say whether the child is in mild heart failure, that is if you can see between 5 to 14 lung comets, or moderate, that is between 15 to 29, and severe is more than 30. In sort of a pulmonary edema sort of a picture, you can see the last photo, which is showing fusion of all the B lines into bands. So this is what you don't want, and you can monitor with the same, I have tried doing it with our same echo machine, which does give you a limitation because our probes are small and you require curvilinear probes for this, but it does give you the appearance of B lines, which you can monitor in a child with cardiomyopathy. So after having done all this, mentally you need to, at the end of 24 hours, you need to know whether this child who came to you with acute heart failure, whether he had an acute myocarditis episode or whether it was an acute deterioration of a chronic heart failure. So if it is an acute myocarditis, as we discussed, that the symptoms are going to be abrupt and you will not have the subtle signs which we grouped before of GI, of low cardiac output, of sleeping too much. So we are not going to have these symptoms. Also, they usually have a higher incidence of acute pulmonary edema. So they will come with more of a sort of a initially a dry cough, which is starting to get wet. You will have elevated cardiac enzymes. The heart size will be normal on a chest x-ray in an acute myocarditis case. Or you may have features of septal lines, etc. The size of the left ventricle looks to be normal, or the walls may be slightly thickened because of myocardial edema. The left atrial size is normal. Cardiac MRI, obviously we don't do it very often, so cardiac MRI will show you features of acute myocarditis rather than chronic changes where we will have fibrosis. And lastly, you will have good response of function. Most of them, around 70% of them, have good response of function or may even recover completely if it is an acute myocarditis episode. In children with chronic cardiomyopathy coming to you with an acute episode, we discussed that he's going to have subtle symptoms. They're going to be more of type B, that is warm and wet. There will be cardiomegaly. The LV will look either thinned out or it might look stretched like a non-compacted LV. LA will be dilated. MRI will show fibrosis or gadolinium enhancement. And there will be signs of failure. With your management, the signs of failure will reduce, but dysfunction sort of persists. It doesn't really show any drastic improvement in case of chronic myocarditis. In terms of investigations, NT-proBNP is an important one, which will and is quite sensitive, which will tell you whether your management is going at par. And I'm not going to go into the details of NT-proBNP, but your goal should be at least 30% reduction from admission after 48 to 72 hours. Any BNP, NT-proBNP value of more than 500 to 1000 is definitely important, and you will see very sky-high values in acute myocarditis and maybe values up to 5000 to 15000 in a case of chronic cardiomyopathy if he is coming to you in a wet and congested state. Now, in terms of management strategy, the initial primary therapeutic objective, either it is acute myocarditis or it is a chronic cardiomyopathy, would be control of symptoms, relief of congestion, and preventing organ damage. You have to remember that as the ventricular function wanes in a child with cardiomyopathy, the ventricle becomes more sensitive to changes in afterload. So agents which selectively vasodilate the arterial resistance and increase the stroke volume and cardiac output, but have little, if any, impact on ventricular filling pressures and the degree of congestion are the ones which will help such a ventricle. The biggest question remains is how do we transition to chronic medications and when do you do it once your child is out of the acute phase? So after having sort of classified him into ABCD type of heart failure, so your management will vary based on the type. So if the child is warm and dry and there is some mild dysfunction with good RV function, you can directly start ACE inhibitors, either a receptor blocker, but we usually use either enalapril or captopril in our setting. And then uptitrate the doses for a period of next 2 to 3 weeks to your maximum dose. So that is what we'll discuss in our next few slides. If your child is in type B, which is the most common type of heart failure, which you will see, you start with a loop diuretic and you keep a watch on the parameters which we just discussed. Just make the table of presence of S3, the weight, BNP, sodium, and how the cough is. So if you have improvement with diuretics, with normalization of your sodium and stable creatinine levels, you can go to class 8th and the next thing to start would be 8th inhibitors. But if your child is sick and you are not very sure on your ART trace, you are having features, he's starting to show narrow pulse pressure, etc. BNP doesn't really come down, sodium still remains low, and urea goes up with your diuretic, then you have to progress to stage C and classify him as cold and wet. That means that he's having low perfusion with congestion. So for such a child, you would need a vasodilator and a non-invasive positive pressure ventilation, which usually helps in reducing the pre-pulmonary edema phase. With this, whether your child has started diuresing and has become warm, if yes, then you can go to class B and then thus come down to class A, and then you can start with ACE inhibitor followed by beta blocker. But suppose you say the child goes ahead and does not stabilize, then you would definitely require some sort of mechanical support for the circulation. Now, the adults usually tweak their management based on the readings of a PE catheter. So they float a swan gans and they station it into the PE. And they have, based on that, divided their heart failure into A, B, C, D, E, wherein we can go to the clinical signs and the hemodynamics. So A would be where the child is having normal JVP, a normal end organ, with a CVP of less than 10, which should ideally be a goal, and PA saturation or SVC saturation of more than 65%. B would be where you start seeing narrow pulse pressure, you have minimal renal dysfunction, you have elevated BNPs, your heart rate, your patient is tachycardic, and so on and so forth. So what's the utility of this catheter in pediatrics? So definitely availability is a big issue in terms of size. But if you have a well-grown, a good weight child, say a 15-year-old or a 16-year-old, you can definitely pass in a swan if the child is in acute severe heart failure, refractory to most of the therapies. Suppose you've started your therapy and he's not showing any improvement, then at a microscopic level, calculate the pulmonary capillary wedge pressure. So your goal should be to have a pulmonary capillary wedge pressure of less than 15, and your CVP should be less than 10. So that should be your goal. So the current guidelines mention that only if you have refractory heart failure, then there is a utility of passing a swan and monitoring and tweaking your management as such. Now, ideal inotrope, so milrinone is my favorite. It really helps in causing systemic vasodilator, decreases the pulmonary capillary wedge pressure, does not increase myocardial oxygen consumption. And you can start it at, I usually started at 0.4 micrograms per kg per minute and then titrate up or down based on the response. The only problem with milrinone is initial hypotension, because as I told you that these LVs are very, very sensitive to pre as well as afterload. So if you're going to give a systemic vasodilator, the LV, though it is, the stress reduces, the blood pressures will not be maintained and the compensatory mechanism might just dip down. And that's why you can add a touch up of adrenaline in minute doses for the initial period where you think that milrinone is going to cause hypotension. So how do you decide that? So in the patient with a narrow pulse pressure with your systolic blood pressure of 80, which we just saw in a 12-year-old, that is definitely on a borderline BP with a narrow pulse pressure. That tells me that if I drop the systolic further, the pulse pressure is going to drop further, and this is not going to be tolerated by the coronaries or the LV. So that is a time where you start with a small dose of adrenaline. Without giving a milrinone bolus, you directly start the milrinone on an infusion. You wait and watch. If you think that the milrinone is tolerated, if the pressure is over around 90 to 95 to 100, then I quickly come down on the adrenaline. Do not want the adrenaline to remain there for a long time. You have to remember that milrinone is cleared by the kidneys, and if you are having end organ damage or end organs which are, sorry, your kidneys which are showing high creatinine, do not start with a high dose of milrinone. The other inotrope of which is of importance is levosimendan, which we'll discuss in the next few slides. Now, when it comes to diuretics, we know how good furosemide acts in an acute congested patient, but there are few considerations. Remember that continuous infusions are more hemodynamically tolerant. If the patient is already on oral diuretic, and if you have a child with chronic cardiomyopathy who is continuing with a new episode of heart failure, then the IV dosing should ideally be 2 to 2.5 times the oral dose. If the patient is hypervolemic and serum creatinine is going up because of your diuretics, it also reflects that you need to increase your inotropy rather than just stopping the diuretics. So worsening renal parameters by themselves are not the sole criteria for stopping diuretics. So maybe you can come down on your infusion to half, but do not stop it just because your renal parameters are getting deranged. It also tells you that your inotropy or your maintenance of cardiac output has not been adequate, which may be the cause why the creatinine for the worsening. In the presence of an elevated, because in the presence of an elevated CVP, so the kidneys require a gradient between the inflow and the outflow. And if the CVP is going to be elevated, this gradient comes down and the filtration gets hampered. Or even if you take it on the perfusion of the kidney, an elevated CVP is definitely something which will further prevent your creat to come down. So you try and get your CVP down by giving a touch of diuretics and increase your inotropy if your creat is not budging from the high level. Loop diuretic resistance is usually due to a series of adaptations at the macular densa, etc. And you can jump to your second line diuretics, and thiazides are good enough, or metolazone. Now, after doing all this, if the child continues to deteriorate, then it is either refractory heart failure or end-stage heart failure, and all these terms are now clubbed into advanced heart failure. So you can have a child in advanced heart failure in many scenarios. One scenario is where you have a child who's come to you the first time in acute heart failure. He is not being stabilized on your inotropy, etc., and you see the need for a mechanical circulatory support. So that also becomes an advanced heart failure. As against someone who's had multiple episodes of heart failure before, and he's coming to you the fifth time with an episode of heart failure, and now he is not really responding to your medication. So again, that becomes acute heart failure. Advanced heart failure. So there are certain criteria and certain definitions, which is again based on adult patients, which can be reciprocated to our adolescent cardiomyopathy patients. So under the heading of advanced heart failure, you have severe persistent symptoms of NYHA class 3 or 4 despite adequate medical therapy. Secondly, severe cardiac dysfunction because of whatever cause. We are mainly talking about cardiomyopathy with persistently high BNP levels also comes in advanced heart failure. Episodes of pulmonary or systemic congestion requiring high doses of IV diuretics with increase in the frequency of these episodes again becomes advanced heart failure. Severe impairment of exercise capacity with a 6-minute walk distance of less than 300 meters or on your CPET testing or exercise testing, your PVO2, peak VO2 is less than 12 to 14. So we know that this child is going into advanced heart failure and will require, and medications are not going to be enough. There is a mnemonic which is I need help to remind you, and it is an easy mnemonic. So requirement of inotropes or inotropy dependent, you are unable to come off the inotropes. Persistently, the child is in class NYHA class 3 or class 4 with high BNP, end organ dysfunction, which is worsening even further, ejection fraction, which is less than 20%. There's a history of arrhythmias requiring shocks, multiple hospitalizations, edema and requirement of increasing doses of diuretics, low blood pressure. So these are all markers of advanced heart failure. which would require mechanical circulatory support. So if you have a child in acute heart failure who is not responding to your medical therapy, or who is inotropy dependent, or who continues to have organ dysfunction, we will require mechanical circulatory support. In case of acute myocarditis, we know that it is going to be short term. And what other options which we have? So now this is again a classification which is for children and adults. So usually adolescents and adults who require a mechanical circulatory support, and based on the level, so 7, 6, 5, 3, 2, 1. So they have classified, so one is a critical cardiogenic shock, a crash and burn where the child doesn't give you any time and you require to put some sort of a mechanical circulatory support, may it be ECMO or whatever. So one is the critical child. Two is you have started on your inotropes, but he's not doing too well. So that is two. Three would be who is inotropy dependent, where he is eating now, he is sitting up, trying to take a few steps, but you cannot come down on your inotropy. And four would be frequent flyer. So frequent flyer is recurrent decompensation, wherein you control his heart failure, shift into oral medication, then he comes back to you in 3-4 months again with an episode of acute heart failure. Five would be exercise intolerance. So your 1, 2, and 3 are the ones where you will require mechanical circulatory support, and this is known as Intermax classification. Adults have a lot of short-term options like IBP impeller, but in pediatrics we have only ECMO, which is a sort of readily available in most of the centers. So we are going to rush through the basics of ECMO. Provides a full systemic circulatory support and can be used to provide your pulmonary support also with the help of your oxygenator. So however, ECMO is providing a non-physiologic circulation, and sometimes it might be detrimental to the myocardium because we are draining blood from the venous side, which results in lower preload and consequently lower filling pressures of both the ventricles, and then we are pushing it into the aorta. So therefore it sort of increases the SVR acutely, and it might not be well tolerated. So it increases the afterload on the left ventricle. So therefore, ECMO by itself does not necessarily decompress the heart and might also increase the LVEDP, resulting in pulmonary edema and pulmonary venous congestion. And there are a few modifications which you will need to do if you are faced with such a situation, like putting in an LA vent or doing a septostomy, and deloading or unloading the left atrium. And this is a score which you can see, which you can access on www.safescore.com, and which can be used to as a tool to predict survival in patients with cardiogenic shock which are on ECMO, and can be used for the first 30 days. It sort of gives you a predictive value of survival when your patient is on ECMO, whether it was a myocarditis because of which you put. So there are certain parameters including weight, and I think this score is also valid for beyond 18 years of age. So ECMO versus VAD, or a ventricular assist device. So VA ECMO is a modified form of cardiopulmonary bypass, that is what we know. As compared to a VAD, it is going to just support the left ventricle, so you do not have an oxygenator. So a VAD is going to be a mechanical pump to support either your left ventricle or your right ventricle or both, but it does not support the lungs since it doesn't include an oxygenator in the circuit. But there are some advantages and disadvantages of ECMO and VAD. So ECMO is going to provide full this cardiopulmonary support, whereas VAD is going to provide only partial support. VA ECMO can be instituted quite rapidly, unlike implantation of VAD, which requires coring and which requires adequate or accurate angulation of your inflow-outflow cannulas. VAD gives you a better decompression of your left atrium as compared to ECMO. And ECMO is going to be short-term, whereas you do have certain durable VADs, which can take you for 1 to 3 months. So now this is a short-term Centrum-VAD which can be used. Now you can see that there are two pumps. One is for the right side and right ventricle. One is for the left. As per literature, the longest that you can use this is for 2 months. However, the company people do add on that they do have case reports where it has been extended to 3 to 3.5 months. This would cost somewhere around, so the console is the one which is costly. The pump and the tubings, etc., would cost you somewhere around 2 to 2.5 lakhs, but the pump is the one which the company people do rent it out. So if you want to put for a short term purpose, they do give it to you without any cost for the initial few ECMOs. And then depending upon your numbers, you can sort of negotiate and buy the console. The biggest advantage of VAD would be that you can extubate your child, the child can start physiotherapy. And even including a neonate, an infant, wherein you would put Berlin heart, which is not available in India, but can be imported. It is quite costly. We have not yet used it. Mostly, I think the Centimag has been used in the centers where transplant is available in India. If we do not have a mechanical support and we know that a child is in advanced heart failure, so there are reports wherein you can give tonic inotropy. Now we have two options. One is the home milrinone, which is a little bit difficult to arrange for in case your child is small. It would require a central line, and you would require to educate the parents as to how to prepare the injections at home. Or you can do a bolus levosimendan, and there are 2 or 3 pilot studies which have been conducted with levosimendan, wherein you give a bolus of levosimendan over a period of 6 to 8 hours every 2 weeks for a period of whatever time your child is listed for a transplant. The advantage of levosimendan is you do not require a continuous central line. Patient can come to you every 2-3 weekly because it has the metabolite has a longer half-life. And so definitely, but the availability of levosimendan might not be so easy at all places. So this is our patient who is an adult with a failed CTGA physiology, came to us in this was his third episode of acute heart failure. He has progressed to advanced heart failure and he has been inotropy dependent. He has been listed and he prepares his own milrinone. The average cost for him is around nearly 5,000 to 6,000 per day because he requires nearly 4 vials of milrinone. He is currently at 0.5 micrograms per kilo per minute. And so the consumables as well as the preparation in terms of requirement of dextrose is approximately 1,000 per week. So what about the long term? How do you transition into your chronic medication? So suppose if you have a child who has done well on inotropes and your injectable diuretics and you need to transition him. He said that first we'll classify him into ABCD and then we will start with your anti-failure medication. The importance of it being that a heart gives you only certain number of episodes which it can tolerate, episodes of heart failure which it can tolerate. As per this graph which you can see, starting on the left side, this is the first episode of heart failure and that itself can be fatal. But suppose he tolerates that, the child can go on to have few minor decompensations in terms of viral infections, etc. As he progresses into advanced heart failure, he keeps on dipping down, but he will never come back to his normal baseline state. Even if you manage the heart failure with maximum doses of inotropes, and then he will definitely go on to progress to the requirement of either a mechanical device or a transplant. So timely management of new onset heart failure is thus important because the most critical period is post-discharge. So immediate post discharge after a heart failure hospitalization has been well recognized to be at high risk for readmission. Delay in initiation and uptitration of the three major classes of medicines or guideline recommended therapies. That is, one is RAS inhibitors, second is beta blockers, and third is mineralocorticoid or your aldactone. And the time period after diagnosis of heart failure represents a great missed opportunity. So if you have a child who's come to you with heart failure and he goes home just on diuretics without the beginning of these three main classes of medications, you can expect his heart failure to return in the period of next 6 to 8 weeks, and you would have missed that important time period where you could have achieved target dosing of medications. So this is a chart which you can follow. So starting from step 1 to 4, so step 1 is definitely diuretics. You achieve a certain, the lowest possible dose of diuretics which you can. If you can get him off diuretics soon, also that would be the best thing. The next drug to start is ACE inhibitor, and you have to uptitrate the dosing to maximum levels within the next 2 to 4 weeks based on the blood pressure and your creatinine. Once your ACE inhibitors are well tolerated, you can start overlap them with beta blockers. Even if you've not achieved your maximum dose of ACE inhibitors, you can start with beta blockers in small doses and then uptitrate them. And lastly is your aldosterone antagonist. So your goals of therapy would be to return the patient to a euvolemic state as soon as possible. You wean the diuretics to lowest possible dose. Then you start with ACE inhibitor, either enalapril or even the newer ones, that is ramipril, lisinopril. And this introduction should occur after stabilization of heart failure symptoms. You can overlap it with your inotrope. Say you are on, the child is on milrinone and you are on tapering dose of milrinone. You can start with ACE inhibitors with a test dose and see how the child does. Uptitrate them, if possible, over 2 weeks. Older children, you can give a longer acting ACE inhibitors like ramipril or perindopril. The ones who are less than 4 months of age, they do not really tolerate ACE inhibitors very well. And even a small drop of blood pressure from, say, below 10% of the baseline, or an increase in creatinine of more than 30 to 50% from the baseline, is what you have to watch for. In beta blockers, carvedilol, metoprolol, misoprolol, these are the ones which are chosen for heart failure therapy. This is a good a paper where you can read in detail as to how to initiate, continue, and switch your heart failure medications. In terms of digoxin, there are multiple reports, and now most of the cardiology societies have mentioned that there are no pediatric data supporting the use of digoxin in children with structurally normal hearts and systolic dysfunction, and therefore there is no role in heart failure. This is the maximum doses of these medications. So in terms of carvedilol, you start at 0.1 and you go up to 1 milligram per kilo per day. So this is the uptitration. For enalapril, you start at, give a test dose of 0.05, start at 0.1, and then you go up to 0.5 per day per kilo. Lastly, a word about ARNI. So everyone's very excited. It has shown a lot of, it has shown nearly 20 to 30% mortality and morbidity benefit in patients with heart failure. So ARNI is a combination of valsartan and sacubitril. We know that the compensatory mechanisms which are counter-regulatory or which are harmful when heart failure starts are threefold. One is the neuroendocrine or the neuropeptides. Secondly is the sympathetic nervous system, and thirdly is the renin-angiotensin aldosterone system, which all three systems get activated once a child is in heart failure. Now, the neuropeptides are beneficial to us. They help in vasodilation, decrease the fibrosis, and prevent chronic changes in the myocardium. So, sacubitril prevents the degradation of these neuropeptides. But it also prevents degradation of angiotensin too. And to counteract that, valsartan has been added. So valsartan acts as an angiotensin type 1 receptor antagonist, and it causes blockage of RAS. both of these systems, both of these medications in a combination has shown a definite benefit in patients with heart failure, irrespective of etiology, but more for the ones with ischemic cardiomyopathy and with post myocarditis cardiomyopathy. FDA has approved the use of this in children beyond 1 year of age. There are good papers which tell you how to use them, and there are newer guidelines on using of RNA which has been published in by the European Society. So when to start RNA? So firstly, you can start them in place of ACE inhibitors, wherein you are tapering the inotropes and you would want to give a test dose. So you can start them that time, or you can switch an already patient who's already on ACE inhibitor, you can switch him to RNA after stopping the ACE inhibitor for 36 hours because of the issues with renal perfusion and creatinine. Initial guideline was that you first initiate the ACE inhibitor, take it to a maximum dose, then you stop it for 36 hours and then add RNA. So this is no longer holds true. It can be started as a drug of choice, de novo, without starting ACE inhibitor. I usually start with a dose of 0.8 milligram per kilo, and you can up titrate it to 3 milligram per kilo per dose twice a day. So this would be your the three panels which are required once your acute heart failure is controlled. These are the drugs which have to be there in the prescription and which require up titration gradually. ACE inhibitors and ARNI should be the ones which should be up titrated first, and followed by beta blockers and aldosterone antagonists.